All right. So, yeah, thanks everybody for coming. Now this delay is kind of fun to deal with. Much like the legend who was just on stage before me, this whole public speaking thing makes me terribly fucking nervous. Oh, right. By the way, my talk comes with a parental advisory. What? Fisheye. This is awesome. If you don't know this lens, that's a super cool lens, about 180 degree, like super wide angle. So my talk comes with a parental advisory warning. Maybe some of you are familiar with Dave McClure. So if you're offended by fuck, shit, piss, cock, suck, motherfucker, tits, ass, or pussy, you should probably go check out the food over there, because I don't like public speaking either, and when I get nervous, I tend to swear a fuckload. Yeah, we're a pretty intimate group here right now, and this whole standing on stage thing really pisses me off. Right. There we go, that's better. Okay, I'm gonna drive the sound guy absolutely nuts right now because I'm this close. There's another thing I like to do. I tend to talk with my hands, so I like to take the cap off the water bottle while I'm talking. Ooh, there it is, you see? Okay. So for real, how many of you out here are in university right now? Show of hands. Okay, and how many of you are studying medicine because that's what your parents want you to do? Ah, see, that got the laugh, because that's the one I often hear, like in the Middle East or Africa, is like, oh yes, go and get a good profession, be a doctor, and have a nice stable life. A nurse? Was that? Engineer, oh, that, is that another one? Is that an engineer? Is that really what you want to do?
At first I thought I want this, but after getting into college and see the engineering curriculum, I hated it. So I still hate it, yeah. But I'm trying to change it.
So are you still studying it though?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know.
Yeah. Fuck shit. Oops, sorry sound guy, sorry. Right, so much like you, I went to university and I studied opera because that's what my mom wanted me to do, right? And my mom was a big opera fan and she discovered, oh, hey, you can sing, so hey, well, you should go to university and study and be an opera singer and la 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 la. And so being the dutiful young son that I was, I did go to the Eastman School of Music in Rochester, New York, rated as the number one music school in the United States of America. Thank you very much. Big fucking deal. And I got my degree and I moved to New York City, much like most opera singers do, and I did what most young opera singers do, which is a lot of shitty jobs. And I waited on tables, and I worked a lot of temp office jobs, and I collected a lot of gray paychecks doing a lot of gray things that I didn't like to do. But I made a deal with myself, and I said, look, when I get to the 100th audition and the rejection, I'm going to go look for something else, right? So that day came and went, and like every 20-something, when I decided to change my career, I did what, like I said, what most every 20-something should do, is I went out that night and got properly fucked up. The drugs were good that night. And I met this guy named Josh, and Josh said, hey, you know, you should come down to my internet company because we're hiring. And I said, yeah, but dude, I'm an opera singer. Like, what do you want me to do there? And he said, well, we're an internet company. Don't worry about it. We'll find you a job. Right? So, I didn't really think much of it until Monday morning, where I fished this guy's card out of my pocket, and I said, oh, well, shit, yeah, I need a job, so maybe I should go check out this internet company. And I did, and the internet company was actually called blahblah.com, no shit, blahblah.com, which is pretty much what I did there for a little while, blah, blah. But I sat down with the boss, Hagai Yardeni, awesome Israeli guy. And he said to me something really, really interesting. The whole interview process, he handed me a pencil, and he said, tell me about this pencil. Now, I'm going to do my best Israeli accent. He said, Bubi, tell me about the pencil. So, you know, I took the pencil, and I looked at it, and I said, well, yeah, you know, it's yellow. It's clearly made of graphite. It has a pink eraser. And he just held his hand up, and he said, no. You are describing the pencil. Tell me about the pencil. Right? Yeah, you know where I'm going with this. You're nodding, right? Yeah. So in that very moment, I realized what he was actually asking me, and I can't remember the exact words, but I responded with something along the lines of, this pencil right here, with this pencil, you could pen the greatest song that the world has ever heard. You could discover a way to make solar panels affordable and put them on the roof of your house to charge a battery system in your house to power your electric car. Oh, fuck, somebody already did that. Right. But the point that I'm trying to make here is that, the pencil was just a metaphor for what is your potential? You know, what can you really achieve? Because like I said, I went to university and studied opera, and I fucking hated it. You know, I really didn't like it. And you're studying engineering, and you don't like it, right? And it took me 37 years to figure out what my point on this planet was to do, right? And so when I discovered photography, I suppose I should take you guys all the way through. Does anybody want to hear the whole thing about how I went from opera to, okay, Jesus, all right, fucking hell, all right. All right. So, yeah, started at the internet company, started out selling 486 by 60 banner ads. If any of you are old enough to remember those, you'll know exactly how old I am. I'm 42. And so I sold banner ads, and that's the day I was actually introduced to the concept of commission. Does everybody know what commission is? Right, where they pay you this flat fee, which will pay your rent, and then every time you do business and close a deal, they actually pay you more money. Holy shit, that's awesome, right? If you can get yourself on a commission job, you want a commission job. So that kind of lit a fire under my ass, and I sold a lot of 486 by 60 banner ads and made a fuck ton of money doing that. And I had a couple other people in a similar position as me. One of them was a day trader on Wall Street, and cotton mouth, it sucks. So this guy was a day trader on Wall Street, and I don't want to say it was insider trading, maybe. But he called me up about 2 weeks before the internet bubble burst, and he said, "Hey, dude, you still have stocks in that company?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "I want you to sell them to me, all of them, now." And I said, "Come on, that's crazy." He said, "Oh, no, just trust me." So I sold 85% of my stocks and took that money. The internet bubble burst about a week later, and I was kind of standing there going, Jesus Christ, Jake, that was a really smart move. Thanks, brother. So I took that money, and I did what a lot of my colleagues in university were able to do, but unfortunately I couldn't do at the time, was I backpacked through Europe. And so I packed everything up in a storage locker and took just what I needed, and I made my way through Europe, and I traveled all around, where I eventually met an Austrian girl who eventually became my wife, who then eventually became my ex-wife. And that's how I got the European visa, and that's how I've been living in Europe for the past 10 years almost now. And I've only been back to America twice, and now that Donald J. Trump is president, I probably won't be back for at least the next 48 years. And I hear some clapping. Please, let's clap for not going to America for the next 4 to 8 years. Yeah. That's pretty fucked up. Anyway, so when I moved to Austria, I suddenly discovered that mein Deutsch ist nicht so gut. And I don't think I need to translate that for anybody, do I? No? Okay, good. So I thought to myself, well, shit, man, what am I going to do now? And I thought, well, I used to work in the tech sector in America, and now I sort of work in the tech sector in Europe by way of, let me start a blog, and let me talk about the differences between the American ecosystem and the European ecosystem. So I started doing that, and, I was getting, like, a little hits here and a little comments there, I'm a hustler by nature, right? And I don't mean that the Larry Flint kind of way, although I do appreciate his publication. I'm a hustler in the sense of like I said, when I discovered commission, like working hard and working your ass off and being financially rewarded for it is fucking great, right? So I hustled and I pushed my articles and I started doing some guest blogs on some other people's stuff. And that eventually got the attention of Courtney Boyd Myers, who was the East Coast editor of The Next Web at the time. And she got in touch and she said, hey, look, I'm looking for a European correspondent. What do you think? Pitch me a few story ideas, which I did. She liked them, and that was that, right? Where are you going, brother? Are you late or am I boring? I'm awesome. Where are you going? Can I come? Is she hot? Is he hot? Oh, all right. Good luck at your meeting, man. I hope it goes well. All right, so where was I? Courtney Boyd Myers, writing for The Next Web. Right, so living in Vienna, Austria at the time, they had this thing at the time. It was called, Manuel, what was it called? Start Europe? Where are my people? Start Europe? Yeah, Start Europe, which eventually became the Pioneers Festival. So the first year they did it, they asked me to come in and moderate, and I sat on a stage with an incredibly intelligent man from Google whose name I can't remember, and I realized all of a sudden that moderating is fucking terrifying, right? Because you have to sit on stage with really smart people and come up with really smart questions on the spot to ask them, and I'm a fairly intelligent guy, but I'm not that smart, right? Right, so that made me really nervous. So the next year they said, hey, can you come back and moderate a panel for us? And I said, fuck no, I'm not going to do that. But I will write an article about the event, which I did. And you know, getting to the end of the article, I realized, oh shit, maybe I should spice this up with a few pictures. Let me go see if I can find some pictures. Let me find some pictures. There are no pictures. There are no good pictures of the Pioneers Festival. Okay, cool. So another year goes by, and they ask me the same thing. They say, hey, can you come and moderate? And I said, no, but I'd really like to come and write an article. But this year, I'm going to bring my camera with me. And they said, oh, yeah, that's cool. Go ahead. Yeah, well, I never wrote the article, but I delivered over 700 pictures to the Pioneers Festival, some of which they're still using in their advertising material today. Thank you. Yeah, so so that was that, and I should mention this. Since there's video, where's the video? Video's right there. I need to mention Mike Butcher, Robin Waters, and Colette Ballou. Those are three people that, if you don't know who they are, you should really know who they are, because those three people are primarily responsible for helping me launch my career. That would be a good shot. Go right here, like right directly behind me, or get that one right. Okay. Everybody look cool. There it is. All right. So those three people helped me launch my career. They opened more doors for me and introduced me to more people than any three other people, which actually makes the point, or I should say I want to make the point, about the power of the network, right? Unless you're James Dean. Yeah, good. I'm glad you got that. Unless you're James Dean, you need a fucking network, okay? You need people to help you. We all need people to help us. And if you're not a good networker, you should really learn how to network. And if you don't want to learn how to network, learn how to drink heavily and still be able to function. Yes, you can clap for that. Personally, I don't drink. Because I like to tell people there are many, many ways on this planet to become intoxicated and inebriated. Alcohol just happens to be my least favorite. Okay, I'm glad you got that one too. Yeah, so the power of the network, learn how to network, learn how to make friends with people, but also learn how to cultivate friendships, right? I mean, friendships are hard. They are relationships, and relationships take work. Yeah. Okay, so after meeting Colette and Mike and Robin Waters and just hustling hard, you know, the phone really hasn't stopped ringing. And I started out doing just general coverage of events, at which point, you know, a couple of these events said, hey, can you do speakers' portraits and headshots for us? And I said, well, shit, yeah, I can. I don't really know what I'm doing. So it was really a kind of a fake it till you make it sort of thing. And I started getting a little bit better at this, a little bit better at that, figuring out how a flash works, figuring out how to balance light, figuring out really how to connect with people, and taking a real good look at myself and thinking to myself, shit, man, I hate having my photo taken. Why do I hate having my photo taken? Okay, well, this, that, the other. All right, let me sort of reverse engineer that and see how I can get people that I'm working with comfortable in front of the camera. Right, so what I usually do is I'll have 3 to 4 really bad jokes that always works, right? So I'll give you guys one of them right now, all right? This is the freebie. So what did one snowman say to the other snowman? Crickets. So what one snowman said to the other snowman? It smells like carrots. See, so bad, that's exactly the reaction I get every single time. That is a pure natural smile, like that one right there. Where's my photographer? That's a pure natural smile. That should be captured right there. So building up, starting off with just like some Vienna tech people and some London tech people, and getting the shots and getting them published and pushing them to the next web and TechCrunch and saying, yeah, of course you can use these, please just credit me. luckily these days I actually get to charge for things like that. And, you know, that just kind of led to one thing after another, and it was one event where, hey, we're having Sir Richard Branson as a speaker, and I said, great, can I have him for 32 seconds? And they said, well, yeah, you can have him for 3 minutes. And I said, no, I need him for 32 seconds. So if you go to DanTaylorPhotography.com, DanTaylorPhotography.com, thank you. You'll find one portrait there of Sir Richard Branson where he literally was coming off the stage. He had the microphone taken off. He walked down the stairs. I said, "Hi, Sir Richard, I'm going to do your portrait right now, blah, blah, blah." He said, "Yeah, I'm really running late for a plane to Geneva." I said, "I understand. I need you to stand right there. I need you to turn like this. I need you to fold the arms, bring the chin down. Oh, give me a little turn right there. And hey, Sir Richard, what did one snowman say to the other snowman?" "Yeah, it fucking smells like carrots." That's right. That's right. Good job, people. You're actually learning something. Man, I feel like a teacher here. All right. See, it's always good to have a good photo. Jesus, what else? Does anybody have any questions? Because I think I have like another 10 minutes. Oh, yeah. Okay, so since the thing is talking about finding your passion, that's a good idea, man. When's the last time you attended a talk where the speaker smoked a cigarette on stage?
Exactly.
Right. So, talking about finding your passion. So, like I just talked to you guys through, I really didn't like doing the opera singer thing, and I just kind of, you know, sort of fell into photography. I guess I'm like the reluctant star photographer, and I really hate that word, star photographer, because that makes me sound like an arrogant dick, but other people have called me that, so I guess that's what I am. When you find your passion, whatever it is, I mean, engineering, yeah, well, whatever. Right. When you find your passion, I'm going to give you a little bit of a warning on that one. And that is, be prepared to lose everything. Now, you will gain everything, but you will also lose everything. And you have to, you know, when you go full throttle and you go all the way into it, you're going to lose people along the way. You're going to lose things along the way. And it's going to be hard. It'll be really hard for a while. But eventually, you know, the reward. I'm an artist, right, guys? So, my life is based on emotions, and I'm getting a little emotional right now. But, I mean, take a look around where we are. I mean, I'm in Cairo. I come from a town in upstate New York where there's 13,000 people that live in that town, and the best job you can hope for is to either work at the electric company or the paper mill, right? I'm going to get to your question in 1 second, brother. And I'm sitting in Cairo, Egypt, one of the most historically significant places on the planet. And even more so, Tahrir Square is right there. Rise up. Rise the fuck up, man. This is awesome. Like, I am so grateful and so thankful every single day for what I get to do for a living. You know, there's an expression, it's been attributed to... That dog needs to be fed. There's an expression that's attributed to many people that I've heard... That I've heard time and time again, and maybe I'll leave you with this because I want to go get this guy's question. But it's find something you love to do, and you'll never work another day in your life. I haven't worked for 4 years, and it's pretty fucking awesome. So, thanks. So let's go get this question over here. And I think there's only one microphone, so I'm going to come over to you. Oh, there's another one. There we go. Okay, so, sir, hit me.
All right, first question, where in upstate New York?
Where in upstate New York? I come from a town called Glens Falls, New York. Does anybody?
Okay, I worked and lived in Chatham for a while.
No shit.
Imagine a brown guy with 240 pounds and 200, about 2,000 people, all white,
yeah.
Living there for a while.
Like, yeah, it's pretty white bread. It's pretty white bread. It's a, I think it's a part of the country Donald Trump would actually enjoy quite a lot. Yeah.
The second question is,
yes, sir.
I really wanted to... If you could touch more on the idea of being authentic. I find this a very big issue with the entrepreneur community. I grew up in Boston, actually. I grew up and raised and got educated there. And it's I find a lot of people think of entrepreneurship as the West Coast and Silicon Valley, even though a lot of the culture and a lot of the norms in Silicon Valley, if you go to the East Coast, which is Boston startup community, it would never be accepted, and it's a very different culture. And I find here a lot of times the entrepreneurs or a lot of the events, it's almost like a copy and paste of Silicon Valley without, while losing the authenticity of the place. And I really, I think it would be good if you could touch more on, you know, being authentic, being doing your things and being professional, but still really finding your voice, your brand in itself.
Cool. Okay. Yeah, cool. I really don't know how many countries I've photographed in. I know I've photographed in the United States. I've photographed in Europe. I've photographed in Africa. I've photographed in Asia. So basically, I think I have South America, Australia, and Antarctica left, right? Do you know how many times I've photographed in Silicon Valley? Zero. I have never taken a shot in the Bay Area, right? Silicon Valley being the hub of entrepreneurship you have to go to the Valley to make it. I think I'm living proof that you don't have to go to the Valley to make it, right? I mean, I've connected to the internet here, so I know you have the internet here, and in my opinion, that is all you need. All you need is the internet, right? I mean, I sit on airplanes and I sit in airport lounges and I'm banging out portraits of Steve Wozniak, right? I don't have to be in the Valley to do that. Steve Wozniak will come to me. Believe it or not, he will come to me, right? So, being authentic, right? I actually get asked this one a lot, like, about my look, right? I mean, maybe it's the mohawk, maybe it's the vest, I don't know. But it's the eyeliner. Oh, yeah. So I also wear eyeliner quite regularly because I know I have beautiful eyes, and I know you're looking at those beautiful eyes right now. We'll talk later. But the Myriad Aviators are just cool, though, aren't they? Yeah, actually, by the way, you know what Myriad Aviators say? Yeah, they say, I'm fucking in charge. That's what they say, because that's what bosses wear. Where was I? I'm a little off now. Authentic, right, yeah, thanks, cool. So, I get asked about my look all the time, and I'll be honest, I do it to stand out. I mean, a lot of photographers like to blend in, but I don't like to blend in, right? I mean, my philosophy is, if I don't look good, how the fuck am I going to make you look good, right? So, being authentic, this is who I am. You know, I mean, this is not an act. I mean, I actually get that sometimes. I've heard people refer to the Dan Taylor show, which in a way I think, yeah, hey, that's cool. That's an experience, right? Because when I photograph someone, when I do a headshot or when I do an event, I do like to make it an experience. I don't like to have just a, hey, stand there, turn this way, turn that way. Okay, we're done. I like to walk away like knowing a little bit more about that person, because my job is not to take their photograph, but it's actually to capture a moment in their life. And that's what I like to do. If I'm not authentic, how am I going to draw authenticity out of that person? And I guess looping this back to the entrepreneurship thing is, you know, don't lie to yourself. Don't be an engineer, right? Don't do it because that's what you're expected to do or that's what you think you should do. Maybe it'll take you 5 years to figure it out. Maybe it'll take you 5 minutes to figure it out. It took me, like I said, 37 years to figure out, okay, my job on this planet is to be a photographer. And more so, I'm trying to graduate even more beyond a photographer, but rather a visual artist that happens to use a camera because I can't draw and I really suck at painting. Right, and I know there's a question over here, young lady. I like your sunglasses, by the way. Can we get her a microphone, or do you want me to just come to you? Ooh, look, he's running.
Hello, Dan.
Yo,
I'm
what
a
up?
Really big fan of your work. You make conferences interesting.
Thank you.
So I really wanted to come to this talk because I feel, as a young generation now in this anything's possible kind of world, we are actually kind of fetishizing fashion to the extent that it's getting to people's head, and it's actually becoming more of a prison than a way to escape all of this that you've, like, oh, I need to find my passion, or this is my passion, and then... So it's kind of become a fetish, and I want to hear your thoughts about that. My second question is, can I get a Dan Taylor headshot?
Okay, so... fetishism, well, that's an interesting topic. I do enjoy my fair share of fetish clubs, yes.
Are fetishizing passion when we're, like, in this kind of day and time, we're telling people, like, yeah, drop everything, find your passion. And sometimes it took you 37 years. Mm. So at 23 or 21, when you're so hell-bent on, like, finding my passion, it becomes, like, kind of an imprisonment of sort.
I see.
As opposed to becoming this liberating thing.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. So maybe the best way to address that is to put yourself in really, really, I don't want to say bad because it's not really bad. Put yourself in uncomfortable situations, right? Like moving to Europe, my ex-wife, she didn't like living in the United States. She really didn't like it. And I, you know, as an American, I thought, oh, man, this is where I grew up. This is what I know. This is my people. And I thought, but you know what? I love you, and you're my wife. And, yeah, you want to go home. I get that. So fuck it. Let's do it. You know, and I put myself in a really awkward and weird position where I couldn't speak the language. I didn't know what was going on around me, really. The people, the culture, everything was different, right? So if you're Egyptian, go to Australia. If you're Argentinian, move to Norway. You know, and if you can't move there, just go there. And I don't want to say, like, overstay your visa or anything. But, yeah, we all know how that one goes. Oh, yeah. What's that? Something about a passport, sorry. Burn your passport. I wouldn't recommend that because going through customs gets kind of tricky. But I would say put yourself in uncomfortable situations, you know, because I think that growth can only happen through, I don't want to say pain, but a hardship, right? You know, Steve Jobs didn't come back to Apple and make it one of the most successful company ever because he stayed there, right? I mean, he got kicked out. He got forced out of his own company, and that must have sucked, really sucked. But he didn't dwell on it. He didn't dive deep into depression and sort of, you know, fade off. I mean, yeah, we all know that Steve Jobs was a remarkable man. But he was in an uncomfortable situation, right? He had to retool everything, and he figured out a way to, well, whether Hollywood will tell us the truth about this or not, but he figured out a way to engineer his way back into the company and take back everything that he had once built and built it into something really phenomenal. And speaking of Steve Jobs, hopefully, fingers crossed, everybody cross your fingers for me right now. Next week in Paris, I'll be working with Tony Fadell on some new headshots. So hopefully, Tony, if you're listening, if you're on the video, buddy, let's do this, all right? Cool. Fetish, passion, is that it? Does that answer it? You want a headshot? Come here. I feel like we're leaving everybody out here, so I'm going to try to do a one-handed headshot. Couple tips on photography right now, right? So these are a few things that I've learned. What makes a photo great isn't always necessarily what you're shooting, but what's in the background, right? Because if you have a... No, you're gorgeous. This is going to be awesome, okay? So what I'm going to do is use... Actually, let's do this. Come on up here. Okay. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, that's really good. Okay, I don't want those light poles in your head. I do. I'm definitely going to direct you. Are you right-handed or left-handed? You're right-handed. Okay, so give me a quarter a turn that way. A little bit more towards me. Take your right foot, cross it over your left. Now, see, you just hit your red carpet pose right there. Your body just became a diamond shape. I like the top. Let me see the boss pose. Pull me the... Oh, shit, that's good. You've done this before, haven't you? Okay. All right. Can I touch your hair? Okay, good. I just want to get this like that. There's a little bit like that. Let's get that like that. Da, 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 da. Also, as a photographer, you also have to become a makeup artist, a stylist, a wardrobe person, and a comedian as well. All right, so we got a nice, clean background here. Put your hands up. There we go, nice. Okay, all right, so I'm going to say ISO 200 f1.2 at 100, let's go a 60th of a second, yeah? All right.
Okay, so, ooh, that's good. Ooh, that's nice. Very nice.
Bring the chin down for me just a touch. Ooh, there you go. And turn a little bit more towards me with the body. There you go, right there. Chin down, tiny little bit. There it is. We're going to get your new Tinder photo right here. Remember that thing I said about being a comedian? Wait till you see the smile. Look at that. What do you think?
Fancy Lord.
Oh, thank you. Give me a hug. Ooh, and she
so
smells nice,
we could
too.
Like, we could listen to you go on and on and on.
I know, I'm
we
way
could
over.
Forever.
Shit,
no, no, you're not way over. It's
sorry.
All good. Dan, I do, before we finish, I want to ask you from kind of a media point of view.
Yes.
You've shot many, many people. How do you deal with a difficult person?
I get divorced.
And
no,
in
no,
your
seriously.
Work life?
Okay, so how do I deal with a difficult person? Yeah, that's actually that's another thing. In addition to being a makeup artist and photographer and a comedian, you also have to be a psychiatrist, and you have to figure out a person in 10 seconds or less, like what kind of a day are they having. To deal with a difficult subject, I've actually said, hey, you know what? We've got an hour scheduled for the shoot. I actually really only need you for about 6 minutes, so let's go get a drink. Or yeah, alcohol works, usually.
Alcohol.
Right? Alcohol or food. Yeah, you know, I basically, if they're difficult, if they don't like being photographed, if they don't want to be photographed, one of the things that I'll do is I'll give them the camera, right? And I'll line up the shot and I'll say, okay, look, all you have to do is just press this button right here and then I'll pose for them. And some of my best shots are actually shot by people who didn't want to be photographed that day. Yeah. So I will put them on the other side of the camera and let them do the shoot for a few minutes, and then I'll say, hey, look, you see, that really wasn't that difficult, so now we trade spots, and I'm going to photograph you, and we're going to have a good time.
And that's always been the case, or after you've become well-known?
No, that's always been
easier?
The case.
Does it get easier? Or
yeah, it never? Does get easier. Everything gets easier. Everything gets easier.
So, well, it's been a pleasure having you tonight.
Thank you very much.
This evening.
Thanks.
Thank you for coming.